Good evening. My name is Janet Lang. I'm on the faculty at the Balsillie School of International Affairs. And it is my pleasure to moderate this evening's CIGI signature lecture, which is entitled This Close to Nuclear War, Robert McNamara's Cuban Missile Crisis. The Cuban Missile Crisis of 1962, which many of you in the audience remember, and a number of you were less than glimmers in your parents' eyes at that point, so it'll be new stuff. Cuban Missile Crisis of October 1962 was clearly the most dangerous crisis of the nuclear age. U.S., Russian, and Cuban leaders at that time felt themselves close to the brink of a catastrophic nuclear war. Research on the crisis over the past quarter century suggests that the risk of nuclear war in October 1962 was actually even greater than those leaders, John F. Kennedy, Nikita Khrushchev, and Fidel Castro, believed at the time. In the 2004 Academy Award-winning documentary film by Errol Morris, The Fog of War, former U.S. Defense Secretary Robert McNamara held up his thumb and forefinger in front of the camera until they almost touched, and he said, "We came this close to nuclear war, this close to the total destruction of U.S., Soviet Union, Cuba, and much of the rest of the world as well. The world as we know it could have been destroyed in October 1962. And a primary reason why this did not happen, according to McNamara, was luck. We lucked out, he says, in the fog of war. So we're gathering here tonight on the 48th anniversary of the crisis. And we have three distinguished scholars who will have joined me on the stage here tonight at CIGI. They all have a great deal of experience working with McNamara and on McNamara's life and career. They will address some questions that have puzzled scholars ever since the October 1962 event. Questions such as, why did the crisis occur? What caused it to spin out of control? How close did the crisis come to nuclear war? What would likely have happened if nuclear weapons had been used by either side in or around Cuba? And in addition, they will also ask, what lessons do Robert McNamara's experience of the crisis, his experience in October 62, and his subsequent historical research, offer to leaders and citizens alike who wish to reduce the risks of nuclear war in the 21st century so that nothing as dangerous as the missile crisis will ever happen again? Nuclear war could have happened in October 1962. The risk of nuclear war remains with us even as our awareness of this risk has receded. As the title of this evening's program indicates, to delve into the risk and the lessons, we will focus on the experiences of Robert McNamara. Why? Why McNamara? Because of his central role in the crisis, of course. President Kennedy believed that without McNamara restraining the hawks in the U.S. military, that impulsive action leading to a disastrous war would have been likely. But there's actually another reason. Over the last 25 years of his life, Bob McNamara engaged in a rigorous and unprecedented examination and re-examination of the crisis, an enterprise that eventually drew in Russian and Cuban leaders and a substantial number of declassified documents from all three countries. We like to talk about, in a sense, these two McNamaras. There's the U.S. Secretary of Defense, who acted in October 1962. We call that one McNamara 1.0. And then there's McNamara, the unorthodox historian, the peripatetic and sometimes quixotic octogenarian, who was willing to go anywhere and meet with anyone who might shed light on the Cuban Missile Crisis. And we call that one McNamara 2.0. The panel's presentation tonight will begin with a dramatic 5-minute excerpt of McNamara recalling the crisis from the fog of war. Following the excerpt, I will introduce our speakers in turn just before they deliver their remarks. As the presenters are speaking, please feel free to write out a question or two. There should be blank question sheets there and pencils on your seats. And periodically through the night, the CIGI staff will collect these questions and then we'll be able to use them for the Q&A discussion. If there's a particular person on the panel that you want to direct your question to, just please indicate that. So let's start with the clip.
Now, I remember exactly the sentence I left off on. I remember how it started, and it was cut off in the middle, but you can fix it up some way. I don't want to go back introduce the sentence because I know exactly what I wanted to say.
Go ahead.
Okay. Any military commander who is honest with himself or with those he's speaking to will admit that he has made mistakes in the application of military power. He's killed people unnecessarily. His own troops or other troops, through mistakes, through errors of judgment. 100 or thousands or tens of thousands, maybe even 100,000. But he hasn't destroyed nations. And the conventional wisdom is don't make the same mistake twice. Learn from your mistakes. And we all do. Maybe we make the same mistake 3 times, but hopefully not 4 or 5. There'll be no learning period with nuclear weapons. You make one mistake, and you're going to destroy nations. My 7 years as secretary, we came within a hair's breadth of war with the Soviet Union on 3 different occasions. 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, for 7 years as Secretary of Defense, I lived the Cold War. During the Kennedy administration, they designed a 100 megaton bomb. It was tested in the atmosphere. I remember this. Cold War? Hell, it was a hot war. I think the human race needs to think more about killing, about conflict. Is that what we want in this 21st century? I want to say, and this is very important, at the end, we lucked out. It was luck. that prevented nuclear war. We came that close to nuclear war at the end. Rational individuals. Kennedy was rational. Khrushchev was rational. Castro was rational. Rational individuals came that close to total destruction of their societies. And that danger exists today. The major lesson of the Cuban Missile Crisis is this. The indefinite combination of human fallibility and nuclear weapons will destroy nations. Is it right and proper that today there are 7,500 strategic offensive nuclear warheads, of which 2,500 are on 15-minute alert to be launched by the decision of one human being?
Our first speaker is Fred Logevall, the John S. Knight Professor of International Studies at Cornell University and the Director of Cornell's Mario Einaudi Center for International Studies. Fred is, by acclamation, his generation's most important historian of the war in Vietnam. His landmark 1999 book, Choosing War, has changed the face of the field. It contains the astounding thesis that President Lyndon Johnson chose war knowing that it was nearly impossible for the war in Vietnam to be won. Like all of Fred Logevall's work, Choosing War is well documented, well argued, and very well written. Since Choosing War, Fred has broadened his field of vision beyond the Vietnam War. His latest book, written with Campbell Craig, is called America's Cold War, The Politics of Insecurity. It was published last year to great acclaim. Fred has also recently begun work on a biography of Robert McNamara, and Fred will lead off tonight with some remarks about the McNamara that we're calling 1.0, the McNamara of October 1962. Born in Stockholm, Sweden, Fred grew up in Vancouver, attended Simon Fraser in Yale, and in 2008, he added American citizenship to his Swedish and Canadian citizenship just in time to cast his vote for Barack Obama for U.S. president. Please welcome Fred Logevall of Cornell University.
Well, I don't know that Janet is supposed to give my political affiliation, but It's wonderful to be here with you this evening. It's my first visit to Waterloo, but it does feel like I'm coming home. As Janet said, I played a Canadian for about 12 years, albeit in British Columbia. And I always look for a reason to come back. And now I have this reason. And it's wonderful, full house, this marvelous setting, a nice fall day, hockey season has begun. What could be better? As Janet says, we're talking tonight about one figure in the drama of the Cuban Missile Crisis, Secretary of State Robert McNamara. And I want to say at the outset that it's a little bit unnerving for me to be up on stage with these three particular individuals, David, Jim, and Janet. As I think probably most of you know, perhaps all of you know, they know more, or at least I would argue, that individually, never mind collectively, they know more about McNamara, or as much about Robert McNamara, as anybody, anywhere. And perhaps in particular about McNamara with respect to the Cuban Missile Crisis. And so here I am, trying to find something interesting and useful to say with the three of them up here with me. We'll see how it goes. I had thought I would come and speak about Vietnam, but no such luck. Although, as you'll find out, I couldn't quite resist. In fact, I want to make 3 points this evening. And the third point that I want to make does, in fact, try to connect or at least offer some observations about McNamara and the connection between the missile crisis and the escalation in Vietnam 2.5 years later. Now, what I did in preparation for tonight is this. What I did in terms of preparation was I went through the transcripts in various forms, there are various iterations, the transcripts of the White House tapes. Kennedy, as I think many of you know, had a White House taping system installed earlier in 1962. The exact reasons for this are not quite clear. Probably he thought that they would be helpful when the time came to write his memoirs. So we have a terrific resource, which is the White House tapes. Like any resource, those tapes need to be used with caution. But what I decided I would do for tonight is I would go through the transcripts of those tapes, and I also listened to a few of them. I would go through them, and I would try to get a sense of the whole XCOM, the whole advisory system during the 13 days, but I would pay special attention to Mr. McNamara. To some extent, I would try to isolate McNamara to get a sense of his role in the crisis. Because as Janet said, my function tonight is McNamara 1.0. Jim will then come up and I think speak to us about McNamara 2.0. And here I wish to make 2 points on the basis of this investigation. The first point is this. The latter day McNamara is not a reliable guide. McNamara says in Fog of War, Kennedy was trying, and I quote, Kennedy was trying to keep us out of war. I was trying to help him keep us out of war. Well, the first part of that assertion is incontrovertibly true. And I, in fact, want to spend a few moments of my time this evening talking about John F. Kennedy's role in the crisis. There's no doubt in my mind that Kennedy, in fact, was trying to keep the United States out of war. The second assertion, namely McNamara saying, I was trying to help him keep us out of war, is also true to a degree. It's true initially, in particular in the first 2 days of the crisis, October 16 and October 17. After the second day, however, McNamara often was more of a hawk in the deliberations, advocating the bombing of the Soviet missile sites, which of course were surreptitiously being installed on Cuba, and then invading the island of Cuba itself, even if doing so risked sparking a larger war with the Soviet Union. Let's look at this a little bit more in detail. On the first day of the crisis, October 16, McNamara is among the few advisors who caution against attacking the Soviet missile sites before first thinking through the consequences. He advocates instead a naval blockade of Cuba, at least as a way to buy time. And what he's doing here, I think, is he's considering the stakes, he's considering the possibility of nuclear war, and to him and to the president, the blockade seems the safer option. Moreover, and I find this absolutely fascinating, moreover, it would not put the United States in the morally dubious position of launching a surprise preventive attack such as the Japanese had done at Pearl Harbor, such as, thinking ahead if we might, a certain American president did against a certain country in March of 2003. So a blockade could prevent the Soviet Union from increasing its deployment of missiles on the island and create a more stable situation in which negotiations would occur without obviously appearing to the Soviets as a military escalation. It could also deprive the Kremlin of an excuse to retaliate by moving militarily on Berlin. So the president pulls the group, pulls his advisor, gets a sense of the room, and supporters of the blockade prevail. For the time being, there will be no American attack on the island. And my sense is, and here is, of course, where I want to rely on my co-panelists, but my sense is that McNamara is important, very important in these early days. And by the way, I linger on the blockade, or as it came to be called, quarantine. Blockade being really an act of war in a sense that a quarantine was not. So the terminology they chose in the end was quarantine. I linger on the quarantine because I do think it has a connection to Vietnam, which is going to be my third and final point. That's why I bring it up here. So that's McNamara, I think, in a nutshell in the first 2 days. However, on the third day, October 18, he switches. And he endorses the Joint Chiefs of Staff's plan for an air raid followed by an invasion. In other words, McNamara says, the tapes record him as saying the following, quote, in other words, we consider nothing short of a full invasion as practicable military action, and this only on the assumption that we're operating against a force that does not possess operational nuclear weapons. In other words, end quote. In other words, as long as the attack is launched before the Soviets have loaded warheads on the missiles. By October 25th, which I guess is day 10 of the crisis, McNamara has given up on the blockade entirely, saying, and I quote, I don't see any way to get those weapons out of Cuba. Never have thought we would get them out of Cuba without the application of substantial force, economic force, and military force. Then on October 27th, known as Black Saturday among top American officials, on Black Saturday, McNamara urges Kennedy not to accept Nikita Khrushchev's offer of a missile trade and recites a series of steps that need to be taken, quote, before we attack Cuba, unquote. So this is the McNamara that emerges during the course of the 13 days. At one point, McNamara says, how can we negotiate with somebody who changes his deal before we even get a chance to reply and announces publicly the deal before we receive it? And a little bit later, you see, it completely changes the character of the deal we're likely to be able to make. And I continue, McNamara, so my point is, we ought to really keep the pressure on them in this type of situation. McNamara then urges Kennedy to turn down a link between the Cuba missiles and the Turkey missiles publicly. Later that same day, the 27th of October, McGeorge Bundy, who's the National Security Advisor, presses McNamara on military options, and the Secretary of Defense replies very, I think unambiguously, the military plan is now very clear. A limited strike is out. So the military plan now is basically invasion. In sum, my assessment from doing this investigation of the tapes in particular and also some other contemporaneous evidence is that the tapes and the evidence does not show that McNamara was JFK's principal ally in, quote, trying to keep us out of war, unquote. Indeed, Kennedy had no consistent ally. I would say Kennedy stood virtually alone against his ex-com advisors. And he later confided to John Kenneth Galbraith, quote, you will never know how much bad advice I had. McNamara would later assert to Llewellyn Thompson, known as Tommy Thompson, who was a former ambassador to the Soviet Union, McNamara would later say that Thompson persuaded Kennedy to resolve the crisis through diplomacy, not force. My sense is that this is misleading. My sense is that, in fact, Kennedy, very much on his own, reached that conclusion, and that from an early point, Kennedy was looking for a negotiated settlement. He wanted to find a way to allow Khrushchev to save face, and substantially was alone in doing so. And just a few words about Kennedy, then. I find the tapes quite astonishing in this regard. And even if we allow for the possibility that Kennedy, unlike others, or at least many others in the room, knows of the system, knows of the taping system, is aware that this changes how he responds when the tape is playing and so forth. Nevertheless, what those tapes reveal, it seems to me, is a deeply engaged, calmly authoritative commander-in-chief, capable of seeing the situation from his adversary's perspective. Now, I hasten to add parenthetically that one could also be very, very critical of John F. Kennedy for bringing the crisis on in the first place, which is perhaps something we'll have a chance to talk about in the discussion. It's certainly a powerful argument in my book to say that Operation Mongoose, the anti-Castro operation of the Kennedy administration, and the kind of fanatical interest that the Kennedy brothers in particular had in trying to remove Castro is part of what's going on. But in the crisis itself, it seems to me that Kennedy comes out looking extremely good. He moved decisively and creatively. He had, I think, a sense of the vagaries of history. And as a historian, maybe this has special resonance for me. I think that Kennedy had a better sense than his advisors of the vagaries of history. Earlier in the year, as I think many of you know, he had read Barbara Tuchman's The Guns of August, which details how European leaders had stumbled into World War I. He came away so impressed with that book that he often quoted from it. He often urged advisors to go out and read it. And I would say that we can all be, after all, we're still here. We can all be grateful that Kennedy showed restraint. Had somebody else been president in October of 1962, the outcome might well have been very different. And I think it shows lots of things that we can talk about. One is that it shows Kennedy's capacity for empathy, which I think is a critical concept that Jim and Janet have written about, and I hope we can talk about. It also shows, it seems to me, that human agency in this crisis matters a great deal. Personalities matter. It matters who was president. It matters who was the Soviet leader at the time. So those of you who are students in the room, when your professors tell you that it's all about structure, it's all about subterranean forces moving history, don't believe it. In this crisis and in others, human agency, it seems to me, is of great, great importance. And this, in fact, is my second point. My second point this evening is that had another man been president in October of 1962, we could have done worse than to have Robert McNamara in the Oval Office. This may sound contradictory to what I've just said, and in a sense it is. Then again, McNamara is a contradictory figure in history, and his Vietnam record certainly shows this. Kennedy later reportedly said that McNamara was his most valuable advisor during the crisis. If that statement is accurate, the reasons for it have probably been lost to history to a large extent. Obviously, a lot of the deliberations during the 13 days were not recorded. Obviously, a lot of the discussions and the debates occurred when the tapes, the machine was not playing. But even in the existing record, even the record that we do have, I think we see signs of this McNamara that I'm talking about now. Though he was more of a hawk, to use the Vietnam era word, though he was more of a hawk than he later claimed, he showed at certain moments, and especially on October 16 and 17, which I think is important, he showed at certain moments, fleeting moments, that he was capable of seeing the bigger picture, of staking out an independent position, of seeing that the quarantine option was not merely or even primarily military, but was in fact a matter of great political importance. McNamara also showed a wariness about pulling the trigger. He was also, for Kennedy, a kind of buffer between himself, between Kennedy and the Pentagon. This, as you know, if you've seen the movie 13 Days, is a theme, a main theme in that movie. And it shows McNamara, almost, to some extent, single-handedly stopping the Pentagon from shooting at the Soviet submarines on the edge of the blockade area. Did it happen this way? Not really. The film, it seems to me, exaggerates by a pretty considerable margin. The nature of the civil-military tensions makes the JCS, the Joint Chiefs, more bloodthirsty than I think they really were. But I think the scene, and you may remember this if you've seen the film, the famous scene involving McNamara coming up in a confrontation with Admiral Anderson, in which he basically dresses down Admiral Anderson, it does get at this larger truth. And I think that's important. So I want to finish with a few words about Vietnam. But my point simply here is that McNamara kept tight control as Secretary of Defense of the ships, of the submarines, of the aircraft, enforcing the quarantine around Cuba. And I think that's important in historical terms. Okay, a couple words about Vietnam, and then I'm going to stop before Janet brings out her hook. The question I have is this, and I'll be brief here, and we can return to it if anybody is interested in the Q&A, or my successors here on the panel can bring it up if they wish. My question is, did Robert McNamara apply the wrong lesson from the missile crisis as he and his colleagues in the Johnson administration, keep in mind it's a new president by the time we get into 1964 and 65, did they apply the wrong lesson from the missile crisis as they were deliberating about Vietnam? Did they refight the Cuban crisis in the jungles of Vietnam in opting in particular for graduated escalation? And I draw your attention here to a quite remarkable interview that McNamara did with a most charming and handsome figure named Jim Blight in Washington, D.C. in 1987, an interview which is printed in Jim and David's book, a terrific book that I urge you to read called On the Brink. And in that interview, I found this very interesting. McNamara strongly suggests that the Vietnam decisions were directly related to the quarantine argument in Cuba, that there was in fact a direct link, that a gradual approach worked in Cuba and would work again in Vietnam. And what you do is you tighten the noose, if you will, slowly. You give the communists an out. As the saying goes, you leave a hole in the donut. But you also make very clear that you're willing to go up the escalatory ladder. So in 1965, the idea is that you signal to the North Vietnamese that they can't get away with what they're doing in South Vietnam, and if they don't stop, they'll pay the price. Khrushchev had blinked in 1962. Ho Chi Minh would blink as well. And my question is whether this represents an accurate reading of what happened in Cuba in October 1962, and regardless of whether it does or not, whether there was good reason to believe that it would work now in the spring and summer of 1965. Here, the best reference may not be Khrushchev, but actually Castro. Did Castro blink during the Cuban crisis? I don't think so. And of course, Ho Chi Minh did not either. McNamara would later say, and maybe this serves as a segue to Jim's comments, after all, Jim is going to talk about McNamara 2.0, that an important difference between the two episodes is that in the Cuban case, top decision makers had access to expert advice, whereas in Vietnam, they did not. In the Cuban case, they had experts. In the Vietnam case, they didn't. Those experts having been purged on Southeast Asia, having been purged in the McCarthyite period of the 1950s. So McNamara would often say later in his life that the real heroes of the Cuban Missile Crisis were the Soviet experts, the Tommy Thompsons, the Chip Bolins, George Kennans perhaps, who were the real students of Kremlin behavior. In Vietnam, we didn't have those experts. I think this is wrong on two counts. First, the supposed Soviet experts don't look particularly sagacious in the vast record pertaining to the Cuban crisis. And second, as I've argued previously, America's policymakers had a better sense of things in Vietnam than they later went on. McNamara is certainly one of them. McNamara would say late in life, if only we had known, if only we had understood the war better, we wouldn't have done this. I think if you look at the McNamara of 1964-65, he had a very good sense of the problems on the ground in Vietnam and of the difficulty of achieving any kind of victory. I'm going to close with the following assertion, or following suggestion. And that is that I'm torn about Robert McNamara. I've always been torn about him since I started studying the man. My co-panelists knew Robert McNamara personally. I did not. And yet, I feel like I know him. And I feel confident in saying that he was never the one-dimensional number cruncher of lore, whose slicked back hair and blunt features made him look, as Jack Langeth memorably put it, rather like a snub-nosed bullet. In fact, he was a man of considerable emotional depth, a man interested in moral questions, and you got a sense of that, I think, in this little clip that Janet showed us. That McNamara, however, even though he was always there, and you see him a little bit in the missile crisis, you see him quite a bit, I think, in the Vietnam deliberations, in a real sense, that McNamara only emerges later on. And so perhaps the real analogy between the two crises, Cuba and Vietnam, and McNamara's role in them is a more simple one. Perhaps in the end, it's mostly about the seduction of power, about loyalty, about the disposition of senior advisors, then and later, right down to our present day, to line up behind the commander-in-chief, regardless of their own personal position. This is something I'll talk a little bit about in my presentation on Saturday at the conference here at Waterloo. In the fall of 1962, Robert McNamara served the president who made clear his determination to seek a political solution. And in early 1965, he toiled under a man who had said that he would not be the president who lost Vietnam. Robert McNamara, in both cases, acted accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Fred. I think Fred has done us a real service here in a number of ways, but we're focusing this panel on Robert McNamara for some very interesting reasons. But Fred reminds us, at the end of the day, decisions of war and peace are presidential decisions. And so we really need to always keep that in mind. I would just underscore something that Fred said with a short anecdote. So there were these tapes, and the senior people in the White House did not know about them. It was until many years later that they found out about it. And decades later, actually, McGeorge Bundy, who was John Kennedy's national security advisor, got access to listen to these tapes at the Kennedy Library. He was working on his magisterial book called Danger and Survival at that point, you know, which is a fabulous book. And we would meet with Mac after he'd go in and listen to these tapes. And the first thing that he told us was that he was astounded. McGeorge Bundy was a very big ego person. Lots of things didn't astound him. But he was astounded by how much, as he listened to the tapes, the president was leading his advisors. Very, very much so. A key issue to keep in mind. Our next speaker is Jim Blight. Jim is the CIGI Chair in Foreign Policy Development at the Balsillie School of International Affairs here at the University of Waterloo. He's a path-breaking scholar and a prolific author of 15 or so books on the recent history of U.S. foreign policy, the author of works on the Cuban Missile Crisis, the Vietnam War, the Bay of Pigs invasion, and other events and episodes of the Cold War. And by the way, he is also my husband and colleague of 34 years, so I speak with considerable knowledge and authority when I say that his tomato risotto is fully equal in quality to his writings on the missile crisis. young. As some of you know, Jim and I worked with Bob McNamara and with the filmmaker-director Errol Morris in the production of The Fog of War. What you might not know is that Bob McNamara's interest in participating in that film project with Errol originated principally because Bob was on a book tour at the time, thinking about these issues. He was on a tour to publicize a book that he and Jim had written called Wilson's Ghost, Reducing the Risk of Conflict, Killing, and Catastrophe in the 21st Century. And so when he talks in there about human race needs to pay attention to conflict, killing, and catastrophe, he's really had taken some time very recently to explore those issues in line with his own experience. So Jim will now speak about McNamara 2.0, the McNamara that we came to know in working with him for over 20 years.
Thank you, sweetie. I just want to reinforce something that Fred said and Janet alluded to, which is that I would put it this way. Bob McNamara might have been the greatest staffer in the history of US foreign policy. He was the quickest person figuring out what the president wanted, and he had a bulldozer personality so that he could deliver the goods as he understood it. And a lot of what happened during the Kennedy administration, particularly with regard to Vietnam, or what did not happen during the Kennedy administration with regard to Vietnam, and what happened later, is largely due to the fact, I think, that the president changed from Kennedy to Johnson. And as Fred said, changed from a guy who was very skeptical based on his World War II experience, based on the advice he'd gotten in the Bay of Pigs episode, early 1961, based on a lot of reasons. This intelligence and rosy estimates that he was getting were just not to be believed. Johnson had a much different kind of need, and that was not to be a failure, and not to antagonize the military, and not to lose a war. And Bob McNamara was the man on the scene for both of those. And this was something that Bob McNamara had to live with until the day he died in 2009. What I'd like to do is give you three lessons that I think Bob, if you don't mind, we call him Bob. He was my co-author. I was his co-author. I was his staffer. It's not easy being a staffer to the world's greatest staffer. He ran us ragged. We're not nearly as old as we look, simply because of our exposure to McNamara and toxicity. The thing to understand about the late McNamara, the 2.0 as we like to call it, is that Bob was willing to expose himself to a degree that very few major public figures have ever done, to put himself out as a lightning rod so that people could take their shots, and in return, he would learn something. He is a classic case of the kind of person we look for in our research, a person whose curiosity overwhelms his fear for his reputation. And we should just add here that a long project on the Vietnam War that all of us were involved with at one point or another was really made possible because McNamara came to Hanoi in 1995 in November. We were with him, and he said, "I'll lay it all out for you. This is our greatest failure, but I will tell you what I think, but you have to tell me what you were thinking, and you have to give me some documentation, you give my colleagues some documentation about why you were thinking it, and then we'll compare. I know I made mistakes, I know that. I've already admitted it in my memoir, which was published about 6 months before. But I don't believe that Americans have a monopoly on mistakes. I don't think you understood us. And if you're willing to do that, I'm willing to do it too." In 1997, we met in June in Hanoi, and that project was totally remarkable from the standpoint of having people sit down across from each other who were jointly responsible for the deaths of 3 million people, and who came to the table believing that everybody on the other side is at fault, and I'm not. Now, the missile crisis is a little different. The missile crisis project for Bob came first, and I really think that he got involved in it because he thought that this would really be something nice to get into, because nothing happened, because they pulled a rabbit out of a hat at the last minute, because it was one of those miraculous things that was going to be a disaster but wasn't. In other words, it was interesting but not terribly threatening. In that, he was totally wrong, because the deeper we got into this, the more wrong he looked, and the Americans looked, and the Cubans, and the Russians. This is a disaster that should have happened, probabilistically speaking. If you spin out the events of October 1962 and the 2 or 3 years of events leading up to it, and you are honest and you're knowledgeable, you are going to get a nuclear war 99 times out of 100. That's what he meant by luck. We lucked out. Now, we managed as best we could. We were in a fog. We didn't know really what anybody else was thinking. We were sure that the Russians were messing with our minds. Not necessarily true. We were sure the Cubans didn't matter. Absolutely untrue. And it should have resulted in a nuclear war. So there's a puzzle here. And he reached this puzzle, I would say, at about the time the Cubans got involved. Cuba was a completely alien environment for our Anglo-Saxon, Irish Presbyterian, former Secretary of Defense, classic white guy. He did not understand the Cuban position in this event. And it was the Cuban position, and meeting Fidel Castro for 4 days, about 12 hours a day in a conference setting, where both of them had to behave. Castro had to let other people talk once in a while, and McNamara had to stop intervening once in a while and correcting once in a while. The two actually hit it off pretty well. Now, what did he learn? I want you to imagine that you're Bob, all right? You are in Moscow, and it's January 1989, and you're at a conference with Anatoly Dobrynin, the former Soviet ambassador to the United States, with Andrei Gromyko, the former foreign minister, and a group of military people of equal rank. The Cubans and Soviets tell you in Moscow that fearing an imminent invasion of Cuba following the Bay of Pigs in April 1961, they had agreed to the deal to put nuclear missiles on the island. Now, what's remarkable about that? Because you know, Bob, you're Bob, you know that you did not have any such intention to invade. In fact, after the Bay of Pigs and that screw up, the consensus was among Kennedy's inner circle, we are not going to touch that island with a 10-foot pole, although we will subsidize some Cuban exiles. And although my brother, the Attorney General, is a little bit wacky on this issue, a full-scale invasion of Cuba, a war 90 miles south of Florida, a jungle war? Kennedy fought a jungle war. It didn't have a good outcome. He didn't want it. And yet, it was the fear of an invasion that was not about to happen that resulted in the offer of the missiles and the acceptance of the missiles, where the clock began to tick toward October 1962. In other words, everybody was convinced in Soviet Union and Cuba that the purpose of the Kennedy administration was to absolutely destroy the Castro revolution, the Castro regime, and would stop at nothing to do it. That meant including the use of nuclear weapons, which was often discussed between the Cubans and the Russians at that point. And McNamara was totally astonished at this, that the thought was that the Kennedy administration would nuke Cuba. Second, how great was the nuclear danger? Bob McNamara and his colleagues believed that warheads never reached the island. The CIA was telling them that they weren't sure, wink, wink, nod, nod, but they actually thought that the quarantine or the blockade line had gone up in time to stop the entry of the ships carrying the nuclear warheads. They had some information on this, but not a lot. And in January 1992 in Havana, Cuba, at a conference, we learned authoritatively from the guy, from General Anatoly Gribkov, who designed the entire operation, that not only were warheads on the island, but they were ready to use. And that if an attack had occurred, an airstrike and probable invasion, as Fred Logevall has said, it would have almost certainly have had to have an invasion, because how would you know you got all the missiles unless you went in there and looked around? Now, you learn this, and you're McNamara, and let me just describe what happened. We got three languages here. We got Russian, Spanish, and English being spoken. There are booths in the back. And when Gribkov said there were warheads on the island, ready to use, and that in the event of an invasion, most likely they would have been used, McNamara, I was sitting next to McNamara, the color went completely out of his face. The same was true with Arthur Schlesinger. The same was true of Ray Gartoff, the US specialist on the nuclear capabilities of the Soviet Union, who also didn't think there were any warheads on the island until that moment. Now, why was this traumatic? Because Bob knew that he might have been 12 hours away from ordering the invasion. Not with nuclear weapons, but it would have initiated a nuclear war anyway, because the fleet in the Caribbean would have been nuked, because any Marines reaching the beaches 35 miles to the west of Havana where that invasion would have taken place would have been incinerated on site, and that 2 hours later the United States would have sunk Cuba below the Caribbean Sea. 7.5 million people would have been dead, and they would have completely disappeared along with the island. That was the plan. He knew that was the plan, but he, like a lot of plans in this era with nuclear weapons, it was an air of unreality to it. I mean, it's too ridiculous to think that this kind of thing could happen in this day and age with sensible, intelligent human beings, rational human beings in charge. But that is exactly what would have happened if he would have ordered the invasion on the basis of thinking that there were no warheads, and yet they were there and they were used. And then what do you think the Russians would have done? You would have killed 43,000 Russians along with 7.5 million Cubans. Well, we don't have to guess. They would have done everything they could to launch their weapons against the United States. Third point, third, final one. How close was Armageddon? This is a very difficult thing to think about, and frankly, we're 2 years away from the 50th anniversary of the Cuban Missile Crisis, and actually we came here to this marvelous country, city, and set of institutions so we could work on this. It is very difficult to focus your mind on the total destruction of humanity. We're not geared for that. We don't know how to do that. We don't like it. We don't like it being shoved at us. But I can tell you, we know not from fiction, not from using our imaginations terribly, but from simply knowing the facts of October 1962, that things got so screwed up, there was so little empathy, so much misperception, that the danger of nuclear war was palpable. If, to give you one more example, if that crisis had gone on another 12 hours or 16 hours or 18 hours, it is very possible that the Soviets would have nuked Guantanamo. Now, what do you think would have happened next? The answer is that Cuba would have been sunk. And then what would have happened next? We don't know. But if you've seen The Fog of War, you know that Bob McNamara estimates that in an all-out nuclear exchange in that particular period, there would have been at least 100 million casualties. We don't know how to wrap our minds around this. We need to learn, because it could still happen 5 minutes from now, 5 years from now, or 50 years from now. McNamara discovered all this because he was willing to put himself on the line, willing to say that I was the guy who was about to order that invasion. I was the guy who did not know which end was up. I didn't think there were warheads there. I didn't think the Cubans were expecting an invasion because we didn't intend to invade, and of course, our motives are perfectly clear. To the Cubans, you didn't need to say anything. You'd already invaded at the Bay of Pigs, so next time you'd send the Marines and do it right. Well, he didn't think of this. He just didn't think of it. His IQ may have been 205, but he just did not think of it. McNamara drew four conclusions from this experience, and I can guarantee you this was really difficult for him to know that he participated in taking the world to the brink of nuclear holocaust, that he played a major role in it. He got involved in it because he thought he played a major role in avoiding it, and I think Fred is right, he did to a degree. But what he wound up with was the knowledge, the personal knowledge, that had war broken out, as Dean Rusk once told David Welch and I in an interview, should there be anybody left, he would have been one who should have been hung from the highest tree and left to rot. First conclusion, a major nuclear war is possible. We know this from history, not from fiction. This isn't on the beach. This isn't the road. This is the Cuban Missile Crisis. This is the nuclear war that almost but didn't quite happen. Second, if a catastrophic nuclear war occurs, the likely cause will be perception, misperception, misunderstanding, and misjudgment. It'll be a lack of empathy between adversaries who could not put themselves in each other's shoes. Third, as he said, the indefinite combination of nuclear weapons and human fallibility will destroy nations, possibly destroy human civilization. This is arguable. It's not totally clear that this is a true statement, but it is definitely the conclusion that he drew. We are fallible, and we have the capability of destroying ourselves. We can't do much about our fallibility, and therefore, final conclusion, we must eliminate nuclear weapons from the face of the earth as swiftly and safely as possible, including by rubbing people's noses every chance we get in the reality of the Cuban Missile Crisis, of playing out the counterfactual, of thinking through the what ifs, and of appreciating just how fortunate we are that we're here tonight to tell the tale. Thanks.
Thanks, Jim. So one of the main points that I think is running through Fred's description to you of the McNamara that he sees, and more importantly, the Kennedy that he sees throughout there, and Jim's description of sort of the McNamara looking back to try to understand his own experience, is the importance of empathy, and particularly the lack of empathy. And one of the things that's interesting is I think Fred is certainly right on target in talking about the importance of Kennedy and Khrushchev eventually locking on to just enough empathy that with the help of some luck gets them out. But you will search in vain, really, if you go through all those White House tapes, which are wonderful, to get any sense of does anybody care what's going on in Cuba? There is zero empathy with regard to the reality in Cuba. And it was there that we really, really needed the luck because the understanding wasn't there. Our final speaker, Dave Welch, is the CIGI Chair in Global Security at the Balsillie School, and he's also the interim director of the school. Jim and I met Dave Welch. Now, with this bright light, you may not be able to see, but I'm going to practically blush here because it was 27 years ago. Good grief. practically speaking. He was a newborn at the John F. Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. Dave was a graduate student, and he worked with Jim on Harvard's Avoiding Nuclear War project. Since that time, Dave has worked with Jim and me on every phase of the Cuban Missile Crisis project, of which Bob McNamara was the main engine. This collaboration has included 6 international conferences, many articles, and several books on the crisis, including what I like to think of as the Blight and Welch Brink Trilogy. It was On the Brink in 1990, Back to the Brink in 1992, and then Cuba on the Brink in 1993. But Dave Welch has since then become one of the world's most accomplished international relations scholars, publishing on subjects as diverse as Japanese security policy, behavioral decision theory, Israeli crisis decision making, and a multitude of other topics. Still, after all this amazing complication, I will share with you that Jim and I, and perhaps only Jim and I, call Dave Welch YW, Young Welch. Please welcome him.
Thank you, sweetie. It's a bit like that game of which of these things does not belong with the others, because you don't actually need me here tonight. In these three, you have all you need by way of resource, both on the Cuban Missile Crisis and on Robert McNamara. But I will do my best to try to add a little bit of value to what my distinguished colleagues have already said. Let me begin by saying that they were modest and didn't tell you everything that you probably ought to know in order to understand why I'm not really necessary on this panel. Fred, I have never actually had the pleasure of appearing on a public panel with before, so this is actually the first time, and it's a great treat for me. I'm a very big fan of Fred. I have to say I've learned an enormous amount from Fred over the years. When I first read his book, Choosing War, which was on Lyndon Johnson's decision to go into the Vietnam conflict in a very aggressive way, I was completely blown away. It's a masterful book, not just because of its depth and its detail and its analysis, but because it's beautifully written. Fred is a historian, and he almost never uses the passive voice. Really a terrific book. I can't recommend it to you enough. Jim and Janet, I've worked with forever. What they didn't say, and what you probably should know, is that if it weren't for Jim and Janet, we wouldn't be in a position to be speaking today on the missile crisis or on Robert McNamara in the way that we are and the way that we can, because an enormous proportion of what we now understand about the Cuban Missile Crisis and about Bob McNamara is a function of Jim's entrepreneurship, his methodological entrepreneurship. Jim's actually the inventor of what, in my view, is the most significant innovation in historical methodology in the last 100 years or so. Jim is the inventor of a method called critical oral history. And he not only invented it, but applied this method to the study of the Cuban Missile Crisis, the Vietnam War, the Bay of Pigs, U.S.-Soviet relations during the Carter-Brezhnev years. The method is an innovation that has enabled us to learn things that we otherwise never would have learned, and to see things in ways we otherwise never would have been able to see them. And it works like this. Documents are great. They tell us interesting things. They're a snapshot of what happened in time. Decision makers who actually made decisions are an interesting resource. They have interesting memories. Fallible memories, but interesting memories. They lived through the events that they can talk to you about. They can give you a sense of the texture and the color. Scholars are a strange breed, but they can add value because they approach the world in a kind of systematic way. They're particularly good at looking for connections between things, seeing if there are unifying themes or trends. Now, documents, scholars, and policymakers in constructive collision generate fascinating insights, and that is the core of the idea of critical oral history. And Jim and Janet organized many, many conferences built around this method, and most of what we know today, frankly, about the Cuban Missile Crisis is a direct function of their activities. Not least because these conferences that Jim and Janet organized led to a massive declassification of a lot of very important documents that we now have at our disposal. So, what can I add by way of value to what they have already said? Jim and Janet knew McNamara much better than I did. I met him in 1987, but I cannot claim to have worked with him closely much because, frankly, I didn't want to. I saw Jim and Janet working with Bob closely, and the man is a black hole, was a black hole of psychic energy. He required constant care and feeding, an enormous amount of hand-holding, and he expected everybody to be his roadie. I was actually visiting Jim and Janet in their home in Milton, Massachusetts, while Errol Morris was filming The Fog of War, and I was there for 2 days, and on the first day, Bob called 7 times, and on the second day, he called 6 times. He required he had to be encouraged to go through this process of exposure to Errol Morris, the genius documentary filmmaker, who beforehand had unilaterally solved an unsolved murder in Texas with his famous award-winning film, The Thin Blue Line. And The Fog of War would not have happened without Jim and Janet essentially helping McNamara summon up the courage to do it and being there to support him throughout the process. So I can't claim to know him as well as they do, but I do think there are things about Bob that are particularly worth flagging and that my colleagues haven't mentioned yet in detail. If we were to understand him, what he was doing as a public servant, and what his legacy actually was. Bob had a reputation, certainly when he came into the Pentagon and the Kennedy administration, for being the proverbial computer who wore tennis shoes. He didn't wear tennis shoes at that time. He did wear tennis shoes in later life. But he was a systems analyst, trained in rational choice, cost-benefit calculation, who had done a degree at Harvard, had taught at Harvard Business School, had been brought into the Ford Motor Company to rescue it, to turn it around, by applying very strict cost-benefit calculations to Ford's product line and its activities. He did all this very well, and John Kennedy was apparently attracted to the idea of having Bob McNamara in his cabinet because he thought that Bob was the kind of guy who could wrestle the Pentagon to the ground, could oversee the U.S. military establishment, large, enormously complicated, almost uncontrollable element of the U.S. government. Remember that Kennedy's predecessor, Dwight Eisenhower, who had been commander-in-chief of all Allied forces in Europe in World War II, had himself warned of the dangers of a military-industrial complex getting out of control just before he left office as president. So Bob McNamara was the guy that Kennedy was going to use to wrestle the military-industrial complex to the ground. And it was his rationality that was particularly attractive. I came to know Bob as somebody who was a profoundly emotional guy. It wasn't that he was not rational, that he didn't do cost-benefit analysis. It's that there was much, much more to him than that. I was very surprised by this when I discovered it, but I saw it over and over and over again. So just to give you a quick example, I was, as Jim and Janet mentioned, I was a graduate student when I first began to interact with Bob, and I was writing a dissertation. One of my case studies was on the Vietnam War, and I had met Bob, and I, of course, was aware that Bob was a very important figure in the Vietnam War. So I actually wrote him a letter. He said, "Dear Mr. McNamara, I wonder if I could trouble you for half an hour of your time to have a conversation about Vietnam. It's one of my dissertation case studies, and I would be interested in your answers to a small number of particular questions. I got a phone call about a week later. Completely surprised me. Hello, this is Bob McNamara. Is that David? Yes, Mr. McNamara. Look, I got your letter. Look, I don't talk about Vietnam. I'm sorry, I just don't. Sorry, I can't help you. Oh, well, that's fine, I understand. Well, thank you for calling me and letting me know. What is it you're writing about Vietnam? Well, I began to tell him what. Then he began to ask me questions. And then he began to talk. And 2.5 hours later, he had told me absolutely everything and more that I ever would have wanted to ask him at that time about Vietnam. And then his final line was, well, sorry I can't help you, I don't talk about Vietnam. And he hung up the phone. Many years later, we actually did a project on Vietnam, and he began to talk about it very freely. And I remember one day after a meeting, everybody else had left to do something or other, and Bob and I were left sitting alone at a table in a conference room. And I don't know if he wanted to make small talk or not, but he turned to me and he said, so, David, tell me about the domino theory. I thought, why is this former Secretary of Defense asking me about the domino theory? Now, those of you who don't know or don't remember, the domino theory was one of the big reasons why the United States became embroiled in Vietnam. The fear was that if Vietnam went communist, then all of the neighboring countries would in turn go communist like a row of falling dominoes. Thailand, Indonesia, perhaps even Japan, right? And here was Bob McNamara asking me to tell him about the domino theory about 35 years after the fact. I said, well, what do you want to know? Well, what is it? How's it supposed to work? I said, well, there's like three different interpretations. There's this model of domino, there's this model, and so on. What's the empirical evidence about these? I'm thinking to myself, Bob, you're asking these questions 35 years too late. And I realized that he was a man of insatiable intellectual curiosity who obviously must have known that these were important questions at the time, but felt that he had a public duty to act without actually getting the answers to these questions. And that struck me as a very, very strange thing. And eventually I realized that one of Bob McNamara's single most important personal attributes was a sense of loyalty. He felt profound sense of loyalty to whoever it was that he was trying to serve. And to make a very long story short, because I realize we're running out of time and there are questions from the audience that various people should be answering, I began to realize that Bob wasn't really a free agent very often in his public life. That he understood that the way in which he could do good in the world was to be a loyal public servant and to offer whatever additional cost-benefit calculations he could offer to particular situations in which he found himself. The most remarkable thing about Bob is that he never retired. After he left the White House, he went to the World Bank, tried to solve the world's problems of economic underdevelopment. After he left the World Bank, he started to write about his experiences, to start talking about nuclear disarmament. He never quit. He wasn't working for anyone at that point, and I think that's when we began to see the real Bob McNamara come out. Now, it wasn't McNamara 1.0, because it was only later in life that McNamara had actually learned that rational choice, cost-benefit calculation doesn't get you all that far. Because the real world is a world populated by emotional human beings, rather like them himself. Human beings, by the way, in his case, who really had a very positive self-concept as somebody who was trying to do good in the world and could do good in the world. Most people don't realize that Bob McNamara was an elder in the Presbyterian Church. Very spiritual man in his own way, although he never advertised it. He spent the rest of his life trying to, in effect, undo his own prior image. He's not the only member of the Kennedy administration who learned that way and who later in life began to write and to speak in a self-critical way. Dean Rusk did it very modestly. McGeorge Bundy did it, I think, much less modestly and quite effectively in some of his later writings. His book on choices about the atomic bomb, Danger and Survival, is very thoughtful, quite self-critical book in places. But Bob took the self-criticism further than anybody. And in that respect, I think he's one of the most impressive public figures I've ever interacted with. The one person who really learned lessons quickly in 1962 was John Kennedy. Everybody else learned these lessons slowly on the installment plan. Kennedy learned them virtually overnight. And it's interesting to wonder why. I would argue, and I think perhaps my colleagues on the panel might agree, that it wasn't that Kennedy had a particular gift. He wasn't smarter than these other men. He was perhaps politically more astute than these other men, but he wasn't smarter intellectually. The difference was that Kennedy bore the burden of responsibility. If he made decisions that led to nuclear war, the guilt would rest with him. That's where the buck stops. And he was fortunate to be interacting in the missile crisis with Nikita Khrushchev, who also felt that burden of responsibility incredibly acutely. The two of them were on the same page once they discovered that they'd stumbled into a crisis neither expected as a result of their own mistakes. The most spectacular example of on-the-job learning that I know. Bob McNamara learned on the job as well, but on a much, much slower cycle. It's a great shame, one of the many great shames, that President Kennedy did not live very long, because quite frankly, I would have been utterly fascinated to hear his reflections on the missile crisis and on other things, the way we've heard Bob McNamara's.
Thank you, Dave. So we've had three fabulous panelists here, and I want to encourage you, if you have some questions, to write them down. There'll still be some people coming around to pick them up. We have quite a few here, so we can easily get started, but more are welcome. So the first one, great, as we speak. So for the first one, it picks up on this issue of misperception and perhaps downright ignorance on the part of the U.S., and here the questioner says, and also Moscow. I would also add in Cuba as well. So the question to the panelists is, with all of this ignorance there, where is the CIA and the KGB? That is, why so much ignorance if we have these huge intelligence gathering apparati around, and what would you say to that? So I'll leave it to all the panelists in any order that you like.
Fred's our special guest. I think he should take that one.
I should have spoken up more quickly and said, Jim, the floor is yours. Well, I would say, and I do think that Jim and David should respond to this. It's a good question, and I think the thrust of the question, there's a kind of subtext, I think it seems to me, to that question, and it's, I think, quite powerful, which is to say that far from being an example of great crisis management, I think the more we learn about this crisis in Cuba in October 62, the more we see that, in fact, what officials in Washington believed and what they said behind closed doors was, in fact, out of sync with what was actually going on in the world outside. And we certainly see that with respect to Vietnam also later. Having said that, in terms of the political problems, in terms of getting a sense for what, in this case, Khrushchev in particular, much less so Castro, as Janet said earlier, what Khrushchev was thinking in the Kremlin, I think, especially as the crisis wore on, there was a better sense of that, led by the president himself. I think one of the points that, David makes very well in a book he's co-authored with Don Munton, a short book on the missile crisis, is that they make the point well that it's important to note that Kennedy had some time here. And so that this problem, I think, that's in the question is a little bit less acute as time goes on. In terms of the specifics, however, which is what were American intelligence agencies saying during the 13 days, how were they advising or not advising the administration and the XCOM on what to do, that I do want to leave for Jim, because I suspect he'll know more than I do.
Well, so why did the missile deployment come as such a surprise? Cuba's only 92 miles south of Key West, Florida. You'd think that we could have seen things going on, we'd draw the right conclusions. Actually, I think the problem did not rest with the technology or the U-2s or the low-level reconnaissance flights that eventually took over on the island, scoping it out for an attack. I think the problem was this, and here I'm relying on Ray Gartoff, who did this analysis at the CIA. It would just be so stupid, so unbelievably stupid for the Russians to put nuclear missiles in Cuba that they won't do it. It's just incalculably idiotic to think that they could get away with it. And if they got away with it in the sense of got them in there, that we would just say, eh, we missed that one. No. But you know what? We now know from a lot of documents, but also for, 13 years, we were colleagues with Sergei Khrushchev, Nikita's son at Brown University's Watson Institute. And Sergei has done all the fundamental work on his father. He's dedicated his life to explicating the many light and dark sides of his famous father. Khrushchev he's in a different zone. Khrushchev is thinking, I got all these missiles in Siberia, but they don't fly very well. A lot of times they don't fly at all. And when they fly, they tend to like land in the dust not far from where they were launched. So what we need is access. Cuba. Cuba's access. That's really close. We don't even care if they're accurate. It doesn't make any difference. He's thinking, we got to fix this problem. We're at a terrible disadvantage. The estimates were that U.S. had maybe 5,000 deliverable nuclear warheads in October 1962. The Soviets had 2 dozen, 3 dozen, maybe less, maybe more, deliverable on the United States of America, not including anything that they could put in Cuba. Khrushchev saw this as a gamble, a hell of a gamble, but it was worth it because this was his thinking. We could correct the balance, it would put some sense into Kennedy, and we can end the Cold War because we'll all be equal. It's a brilliant thought. It's a wonderful thing, kind of like socialism itself. If it only worked, it'd be even more beautiful. But from the CIA's point of view, I think they couldn't imagine themselves into that mindset that was so desperate, just on the level, just on the dimension of the nuclear balance, just on that alone, let alone the threat to Cuba. But just on that alone, they couldn't imagine a Soviet leader being so desperate that he would take that kind of gamble. And so stuff came in, they said, stuff's coming in. More stuff came in, more stuff. Nuclear war, nah. They just couldn't believe it. And when Robert Kennedy went over to the Naval Photo Lab on the morning of the 16th to confirm, he was told that it looks like this looks all, these configurations look exactly like the configurations of the nuclear sites in Siberia. They're these Star of David type things. And over here, it looks like the warheads, they're just exactly like Siberia. And Kennedy sat down and he said, shit. Everybody remembers that Bobby Kennedy said, he knew he couldn't He couldn't strong-arm them into a different conclusion. He was totally devastated. They had been fooled, and they had fooled themselves.
I would have a slightly different take on it than that. Intelligence is really hard, and no intelligence community can ever tell a leader exactly what that leader would like them to tell them in a really timely way. There's always slippage, there's always mistakes. The question is, what kind of mistakes? The CIA did actually alert President Kennedy to the fact that the Soviets were attempting to deploy nuclear weapons to Cuba before Khrushchev wanted to be discovered. So in that sense, it was an intelligence success. It was later than Kennedy would have liked. They underestimated what the Soviets were actually deploying to Cuba and so on, but it was at least a timely warning. Kennedy did have a chance to think about, how do I react to this? And that time was important for a peaceful resolution of the confrontation. So one doesn't give the CIA full marks in the missile crisis, but quite frankly, it's not a C-minus performance. It's a B-plus, maybe even an A-minus performance. I'm talking about the analysis side. I'm not talking about operations. Intelligence communities usually have an analysis proportion, which is most people, and an operations portion, which is the crazies who go out planting bombs and trying to assassinate Castro. That was a complete joke, a complete waste of time and money. But the analysis side of the CIA actually, in my view, did its job. The KGB, on the other hand, was a disaster. They did not do their job. They were amateurish, disorganized, had relatively little good quality information, but at the end of the day, none of that mattered because Khrushchev wasn't listening to them anyway. He did not even ask his American experts how Kennedy might react to an attempt to deploy nuclear weapons to Cuba. He wanted it to work, and he bullied everybody into agreeing with the attempt. So Soviet intelligence was both badly organized, amateurish, and frankly irrelevant because the policymakers in Moscow frankly weren't listening.
Just very quickly, I think that David's point about the distinction between analysis and operations at the agency is really well taken, and one could say the same thing certainly about Southeast Asia. One could say the same thing, it seems to me, about Iraq in 2003. And I'm getting the sense that we can say it today about Afghanistan as well.
Just to highlight on the Soviet side, two points that one gets at what David was saying. Khrushchev, first of all, held the secret of the missiles very close. There were six people that knew. So it was very tightly controlled a bit of knowledge. But the other part that gets to the point, there's the intelligence, but then who's going to read it, listen to it. The Soviets had another whole avenue on intelligence, that is the Cubans. When the Cubans went to Moscow, senior Cubans went to Moscow to discuss the deployment, they were very clear that a secret deployment was a disaster. They thought they knew the Americans, having been there 90 miles away from them and so forth, and they pleaded with Khrushchev to do a public treaty signing, legitimize it. And the Soviets could not have been more dismissive of the Cubans. They're these little guerrillas that just came out of the mountains. What do they know? And so forth. So it's an interesting kind of thing, collecting the data but interpreting the data. Okay. This is get some fabulous questions, so actually I think we all ought to be a little bit more disciplined here. But this one follows up, I think, on this other question. Very creative. We've probably done hundreds of missile crisis things. I've never had this question. So before the October crisis, the U.S. had deployed ICBMs in Turkey and Europe that were a direct threat to the Soviet Union, as the missiles could easily reach Moscow and all of the Western USSR for that matter. Why didn't this provoke a missile crisis by the Soviets? David.
Wow.
Is that cool or what?
What a great question.
Yeah.
I could speculate, but I couldn't give you a a really hard answer, because I don't know that anybody's ever asked that question. In retrospect, that does seem like an obvious question. So whoever asked it
is brilliant.
Is brilliant. One minor correction. The missiles in Turkey, Italy, and Britain weren't actually ICBMs. They were intermediate range missiles. And also, they didn't actually work. They were deployed really for alliance politics reasons, so that those NATO countries could feel like they had, you know, a tangible American nuclear umbrella on their soil. It's not clear that the Soviets knew that they didn't work. So if they did know that they didn't work, that may be part of the answer. But everybody pretended that they worked, so maybe the Soviets believed that they worked. But my guess is, you know, the Soviets had already, for years, had to live with the fact of America. They had an American nuclear monopoly for a very long time. They were already used to American bases circling their territory. In a sense, this wasn't anything really new. Turkey, Italy, Britain, they were already NATO allies, longtime enemies of the Soviet Union. Cuba had been an American colony. Cuba, until 1959, had been an American playground. And so it was unprecedented for the United States to have hostile nuclear weapons on its borders, let alone in its former colony, right? So the psychic shock in the United States was tremendous, whereas obviously it wasn't that tremendous for the Soviets when Americans deployed nuclear missiles around their periphery. Having said that, I will say Khrushchev was really irritated by those missiles in Turkey, and he took every opportunity to point out to visitors that this was an affront and that this was insulting and that he didn't like it. In fact, when he first broached the idea of deploying nuclear missiles to Cuba with his own Minister of Defense, his opening line was, "Rodion Yakovlevich, what do you think if we throw a hedgehog down Uncle Sam's pants?" Meaning that the Turkish missiles were a hedgehog down his pants.
Good job. We're going to stay in the counterfactual universe for a while here, because this is too much fun. Okay, panelists. Any guess how the Cuban Missile Crisis might have resulted if Richard Nixon had been president instead of John Kennedy?
Which, of course, almost happened. A few votes had gone differently in Illinois, or been counted differently in Illinois. We could have been in that situation. I mean, David made a point earlier about the burden of responsibility. So it's interesting to speculate what Richard Nixon, in that context, would have done. And it's an interesting counterfactual, because you can, in fact, leave many of the variables in place in terms of Soviet decision-making, in terms of what the Cubans wanted, in terms of actually the timing of all of this. You've got a different set of advisors around Nixon. That's important. Different congressional implications, political implications, but actually you can think about this. Nixon had been a hawk on Vietnam in 1954 at Dien Bien Phu. He in fact wanted the United States to intervene on the side of the French to save the French garrison, and indeed was even interested in sending ground troops. He even dangled the possibility of using atomic weapons. So that's an indication that perhaps Nixon in the early days of the Cuban crisis is going to be much more thinking along aggressive military lines. But it's very difficult to say. And Janet wanted brief answers, so let me just give you guys a chance to chime in with something. That's part of an answer.
I'm almost incapable of thinking of something too awful for Richard Nixon to have done it. But the question that Fred raises, the burden of responsibility, is a good one, because if it's one thing for Nixon to say, as he said, all during Kennedy's presidency, Kennedy's a wimp, Kennedy's soft on communism. Well, he was saying this before, but he was, of course, always running again. And Kennedy talks about this a lot in his press conferences. Nixon says we should have done this in Cuba, we should have done that. I'm soft on Cuba, okay. And he brushes it off by saying, well, you know, Nixon will be around, you know, we'll deal with him in 1964, we'll see how that goes. I don't know, Nixon and Kissinger hadn't linked up yet in 1960. Henry Kissinger was always running to be the deputy to somebody from his post at Harvard. Nixon did a lot of bluffing. He did a lot of leveraging and a lot of that sort of thing. But you know, in this case, with the stakes, what they were, with Nixon out on a limb already as saying we got to go after the Castro regime and get rid of them, and as close as this thing came, but for John F. Kennedy's insistent, repeated intervention to hold on just a minute, I don't think that's a good idea. And with a different set of advisors, I guess I would say with a fair, but not complete, but a fair degree of confidence that Nixon would have at least launched an airstrike in Cuba the minute he heard there were sites there that could contain nuclear missiles. Whether it would have resulted in an invasion or not, I'm not sure.
Our last joint project that Jim and Janet and I did was a study of, not really counterfactual, we like to call it virtual history. The question being what would have happened, if anything, with respect to Vietnam if Kennedy had survived and been reelected. And we make the argument that you can be pretty confident that he would not have done what Lyndon Johnson did in Vietnam, which was escalate, send in the troops in a big way, because of the consistent pattern of his aversion to the use of force up to that point. It's not, it is counterfactual history in a sense, but it's disciplined by the empirical record of what somebody's predispositions actually were. So I would answer the question by asking what were Nixon's predispositions? And I can't say for sure that he would have used force in the missile crisis, but it is still noteworthy, I think, that Richard Nixon actually caused more death as president in Vietnam than Lyndon Johnson did. He was not shy about the application of force in Vietnam. He was less shy even than Lyndon Johnson about risking escalation to nuclear war. Nixon, not Johnson, went aggressively after targets in North Vietnam, for example. So if Johnson was that much more willing to use force than Kennedy and did it in Vietnam, and Nixon was even that much more willing to use force than Johnson, I'd be fairly confident in saying that the odds of an airstrike with Nixon in the White House in 1962 are a whole lot higher than with Kennedy.
I love the idea that one of the real heroes of the Cuban Missile Crisis becomes old Joe Kennedy, who stole the election for his son in Chicago.
Huh. Okay, I have a two-part question here. So the first part is that I think it was you, Jim, who referred to Kennedy's war experience as having a sort of modifying effect on his behavior. So part one of the question is, can you talk about the military experience of the other leaders in the crisis, Khrushchev and Castro, and how that may have influenced their behaviors?
Well, this is a generation that's known almost nothing but war. Khrushchev was a young fighter in the First World War. He was a senior sort of commissar slash general in the Second World War. He had survived numerous purges of the Stalinist period simply to be alive and available to lead his country. Millions of his own countrymen had died, and some due directly to things that he had done. He was known as the butcher of the Ukraine, where he was from. He pacified the Ukraine. So this is a guy who knows war. Interestingly, it comes to bear in the Cuban Missile Crisis in a most dramatic way And the first of these two controversial letters that he sent to Kennedy, what became the last weekend of the missile crisis. And if you don't, McNamara reads from it briefly in The Fog of War, but you should read it. You should read it, and you should read it again and again. It's one of the most fundamental documents of the Cold War. Khrushchev has known war, and he takes it upon himself at a given moment when it looks like this sucker is spinning out of control and that Kennedy really is going to, either by some motivation of his own or by pressure from the military that he's too young and too inexperienced to resist, is going to go to war. Khrushchev takes it upon himself to tell him about what it means to him to go to war. I've seen war. War has rolled through countries and turned it into smithereens, and it's killed women and children. He goes on and on like this. And to get this kind of a letter at that moment was very important. Now, Bob McNamara, it's interesting, in the document, in the tapes, got almost nothing out of this letter. He said it was 12 pages of fluff.
Jimmy, one quick intervention. Part of the deal, imagine the XCOM is sort of, holy moly, what's going on here? And in those days, you know, you didn't have email. So it came over through this big machine, and of course it had to be translated and whatever. But part of this long letter, which is really amazing, it's 13 pages, but it comes almost in random order. So you're getting page 6, and then you're getting page 3, and then you get page 12. And you're like, this is, they're waiting for something to come from Khrushchev. It comes from Khrushchev, but what is this? So this is part of the sort of sense of how it comes.
And McNamara says in The Fog of War, this is a guy that was either drunk or operating under a lot of stress, or both. Actually, once it was put together, I mean, intuitively, I think what Kennedy got out of this is that's me. That guy is in the same position I'm in, and we got to get out of this together.
On the other hand, Jim, would it be fair to say, Jim, that many in the Pentagon who were pushing for military action also knew war, also had seen war up close? So and I'm not suggesting that one should draw a particular conclusion, but it seems that war experience and having seen it and experienced it isn't necessarily a guide to how they're going to, what they're going to advocate in the crisis itself.
Absolutely. You can't forget for a moment that the great Air Force war hero in the United States, Curtis LeMay, who burned up Germany and then burned up Japan and then nuked Japan, certainly had no lack of war experience, but was the person probably was the most belligerent of any of Kennedy's advisors in pushing and pushing and pushing him to do what he thought was right, which was to, in a sense, to do what LeMay thought he had done in Germany and Japan in the Second World War, only this time the stakes are, the Soviets have given you the opportunity to take them out and to end Soviet communism forever. They've given you that opportunity, and it can start by bombing Cuba and then waiting to see if they make a move. And if they do, you take them out. Now, Kennedy and LeMay fought in the same war.
So this is where it pays to have some emotional people in charge, right? Because the generals who were insistent that the United States should attack Cuba in the missile crisis felt that America had a free hand because it enjoyed a massive numerical superiority over the Soviet Union in strategic nuclear weapons and a massive local conventional military superiority. And that was true. The United States did have massive numerical superiority in 1962. So they felt they could operate with a free hand. Soviet generals felt that there was no need to buckle under the pressure because the Soviet Union had adequate nuclear deterrent capability, which meant the Americans could do nothing. And so in both Washington and Moscow, generals were telling civilian leaders, we can hang tough. We don't have to bend at all. They have no choice but to back down. And Kennedy didn't believe that because he understood human fallibility. Khrushchev didn't believe it either. And in his memoirs, he wrote a very interesting passage. He said, I think it's almost a direct quote from the English translation, When I asked my generals how they could be sure that not withdrawing the missiles would not result in a major nuclear war, they looked at me as though I were a traitor or a madman, and so I said to myself, to hell with these maniacs.
Okay, part two of this question, then. Again, it's on the role that a war experience may play in political decisions. The part B question says, then, what does the panel think about the current situation where many leaders do not have any military experience whatsoever?
Maybe it's the chicken hawk question. I don't know. I mean, the argument has certainly been made with respect to the Bush administration in particular, with I think a broad degree of accuracy that those who seemed most eager for an invasion of Iraq in the summer of 2002 and then up to the invasion itself in March of 2003 tended to be those who had not had experience themselves. The argument's been made by people that Kennedy's skepticism about Vietnam and his determination ultimately, some would say, to avoid a large-scale escalation did have something to do with his own experience. Johnson didn't have that same experience, and that makes a difference. So it's a very large question, but I would say that there is there's something to be said, at least in historical terms, and what I know best is the American experience, say in the last 60 or 70 years since World War II, there's something to be said for the judgment that can come from come with military experience for leaders who later become top civilian decision makers.
In Bob Woodward's new book, Obama's Wars, the impression is given that that the chicken hawk phenomenon has a variant. Obama doesn't have any war experience here, military experience of any kind. And if it's true that Obama's enthusiasm for adopting the war in Afghanistan as his own versus the war in Iraq, which he repudiated, if that's true, then maybe some of that has to do with feeling ill at ease, uncertain around military people, uncertain as to how to interpret what you're being told, uncertain as to whether predictions ought to be received skeptically or who can be trusted. What's the difference between an army general and a special forces guy who operates underground, so to speak? Should this guy get it or should that guy? I'm not sure, and I haven't really read Woodward's book carefully, but if that was the case, then it's also possible that you don't have to be Dick Cheney. You don't have to be somebody who stooped and lied and deceived to get out of the draft and all that sort of thing. You can just, it may be that a certain amount of familiarity with the military way of doing things is a good idea, whether to have that as the commander-in-chief of a major military force.
There's actually a lot of research on attitudes towards the use of force, and there are a couple of findings that are pretty clear and robust. One is that military leaders are actually less willing to use force to solve international problems than civilian leaders, but if force is going to be used, they're willing to use much more. And the standard interpretation of this is that generals know war, and they know it's bloody, and they know things go wrong, and they really wouldn't, they'd rather not do it if they don't have to, but if they are going to do it, they don't want to risk losing because they're not doing it energetically enough. The other really robust finding is that leaders of any kind mostly civilian, are more willing to entertain the use of force early in their presidencies or prime ministerships than later. So there's something about being in the office that disinclines them to want to turn to military force to solve problems. And that finding is even more dramatic in second terms, in the case of presidents that have second terms.
Well, just two quick points. On the first point, David, I'm familiar with some of this research. I'm a bit skeptical, actually. I think that one could see the evidence as suggesting that, in fact, say, since the Spanish-American War, so over the last 12 years, that, in fact, the military leadership has been, broadly speaking, as gung-ho, for lack of a better phrase, as civilians. The other thing I would just say is that it can also have, in the American context, a partisan element. And I was thinking about this when Jim spoke about Obama. Democrats, as I think you probably all know, have felt vulnerable to charges of being soft on communism and then soft on terrorism. I think to some extent Obama may feel this a little bit himself, and may feel and may have felt with respect to the Afghanistan decision that he needed to solidify his right flank, and that the decision he made was at least partly as a result.
Part of what I think you also get in terms of the Woodward book anyway is from both Obama's position and his defense secretary, Robert Gates. Early on, they're making decisions, and then they really find out things are so much worse than they thought when they made those decisions. So one of the main characteristics, I think, that comes up again and again and again in the research that we've all done on John Kennedy is his skepticism. He's not at all ideological. He's just amazingly skeptical, and that's a pretty good quality for presidents, I think. Okay, let's return to those thrilling days of 61 and 62. It says here that it is often said that Kennedy's leadership during the crisis was calm and responsible, but that he was reckless in the run-up to the crisis, that is, the Bay of Pigs and Operation Mongoose. So there's a two-part question. A, do you agree with this? And B, whatever you think on that, could the same be said for Robert McNamara?
I think with regard to Cuba, John F. Kennedy has to be, the verdict is that he was somewhat schizophrenic, somewhat divided. His brother, Robert Kennedy, Bobby Kennedy, the Attorney General, right after the Bay of Pigs failure, for reasons I guess known best to him, but basically accepted, I think, by his brother, the President, decided that it'd be better off living without Castro, and that the answer to how to do this must lie somewhere down in Coral Gables, where they were training the Cuban exiles to infiltrate the island and to bring down Fidel Castro. And of course, the exiles themselves were giving all kinds of rosy predictions about how little it would take to accomplish how great a goal. I don't see much evidence that John F. Kennedy was ever had his heart really into this. But there was a question about what to do with these Cuban exiles who were raising hell down in Florida. And one thing you could do with them is have them raise hell in Cuba. But I think this attitude shows a particularly American point of view with regard to Latin America, which is that I, Kennedy, know that I'm not serious about this. I mean, we're not really doing that much. It's just a little pinprick here and a pinprick there. But it all depends on which end of this you're on. And having done lots of research both in Cuba and among the exiles in South Florida, it makes a big difference. For example, one example. So the exiles blow up a department store downtown Havana. They blew it up. Now, a couple of people were killed, and it was done at night when nobody was supposed to be there. You see? So that was one of the restrictions. So the Americans put a restriction. We don't want to kill a lot of people, but we want to show force. Unfortunately, one of the people who was killed was one of Fidel Castro's relatives. Big mistake. Big mistake. You are attacking us. We also, every bomb that went off, every exile who infiltrated the island gave Fidel another piece of evidence that the Americans were after him, and in Cuba that was good enough reason to support him. Absolutely. To this day, the American embargo is primarily why the Castros are still in charge, because they can blame the United States. And that was true even then.
Okay. All right. Yes, we're going to wind up. So for these final questions, I'm actually going to just direct them to one person. And so we'll do that. Right, we'll go like this. Okay. So we'll go in reverse order from the panel. So Dave Welch, what are some of the political situations in the current world where a lack of empathy could escalate tensions to the level of the Cuban Missile Crisis?
Name your pick. I think empathy is in generally short supply. The places in the world that I worry about most these days are Iran and North Korea. I frankly think we outside North Korea don't understand North Korea at all. It's almost an entirely mysterious place, and it's very difficult to know how to deal with somebody that you don't understand at all. With respect to Iran, I think probably there is a little better level of knowledge in the West, but it's almost certainly still inadequate. I mean, one hears, at least in the popular press, a lot of sweeping generalizations about Iran that, based on not very much detailed study of my own, but just casual conversation with Iranians, I quickly learn is just wrong. And one hopes that decision makers are making a better effort to try to put themselves into the shoes of various different people in Tehran who are relevant with respect to that crisis. Those two are two that certainly are a cause of concern.
Okay. Jim, back to 1962. Can you talk about discussions that did or did not occur about concern about escalation if a particular initial military action was begun? Escalation. Was there a lot of discussion about how this could be contained? Was there a plan that if the U.S. began some military activity that it really could be limited and contained?
No, I don't think so. Not really. I think this is one of the things that was so sobering to John F. Kennedy especially during the first few months he was in office. People from Omaha, its Strategic Air Command, came in, gave him his briefing, had the charts. General Power, the director of Strategic Air Command, explained that if the Soviets were to try to take West Berlin, then we'd destroy the Soviet Union and China and the whole East Bloc. If the Soviets did this or they did that, we'd destroy the Soviet Union and China and the East Bloc, and so on and so on and so on. There was this plan, called Strategic Integrated Operational Plan 62 for nuclear war. It was very inflexible. There wasn't much one could do once the fuse was lit. Now, the bad part about that is that if the Cuban Missile Crisis if nuclear weapons had been used, the United States system is operating at somewhere around defense condition 2. Three or two and a half. But at DEFCON 2, if I remember correctly, about a third of all the B-52s are in the air at any one time. They're basically flying up to the border of the Soviet Union and turning around and coming back, and they're flying up again. So that, and this is continued in a rotating sort of sequence, so that whenever, if the word is given, all out nuclear war breaks out like that. It's not a little something here and a little something there. Now, that's terrible because the world ends, or a good portion of it. On the other hand, as a deterrent to getting involved in something like that, it works great. But it's a high-risk strategy. Now, when Kennedy we have to remember the Cuban Missile Crisis occurs toward the end of his second year. Thank goodness. If it had come, let's say, before the Bay of Pigs, if there had been no Bay of Pigs or some kind of humiliation like that where he was more susceptible to the advice given him by his civilian and military leaders, who knows what would have happened. But more importantly, I think from the nuclear point of view, is what would have happened before he fully grasped the fact that once the nuclear war had begun, he, John F. Kennedy, the President of the United States, really had very few, if any, useful options other than to watch the whole thing unwind. Now, McNamara tried to fix that. This was so-called flexible response all through his term as Secretary of Defense. But when Kennedy was president, it was an inflexible response. It was almost like a knee-jerk action, almost like a sneeze, as some people put it. The nuclear war would begin, and 30 minutes later, everything would be destroyed.
Ooh, we're just having such fun here tonight, aren't we? We're going to end with a big time question for Fred. We'll allow you, Fred, to put back on your Vietnam hat that you wear so comfortably. So in the context, Fred, of what you know about the U.S. involvement in Vietnam, would you comment on two things? A, the U.S. involvement in Afghanistan, and B, the potential for U.S. involvement in Iran.
Aren't we out of time?
Just about.
Well, very briefly, very briefly. On Afghanistan, I would say this, and I think it probably also applies to Iran, actually. And I suppose it's in some ways a rather cynical answer that I'll offer, which is that though analogizing and using analogies is a dangerous thing, that the similarity that I see on Vietnam and Afghanistan is in some ways quite telling, and I think in particular of the political sphere, in the sense that in Vietnam and in Afghanistan, the United States has a weak ally, plagued by corruption, by a lack of broad popular support among the people. And also that there's a very interesting parallel, it seems to me, that can be made with respect to domestic political imperatives. I believe that for Kennedy, Johnson, and Nixon, Vietnam mattered mostly in terms of the damage that it could do to their own domestic political position. It's never really about Vietnam. Never really about Vietnam's geopolitical importance to the United States. I think for Barack Obama, I think the decision, which was, in my judgment, a terrible decision, near the end of last year to escalate U.S. involvement, and I alluded to this, I think, earlier, also had much more to do with Obama's domestic political position, with his maneuvering before the 2010 midterm election and the 2012 presidential election than it did with the geopolitical stakes per se. That's certainly open to debate, but that's what I would say. And I worry, last point, I worry that with respect to Iran, the same kind of dynamic could take place, and that in fact, for reasons that do not have to do with the intrinsic national security consideration, but for baser, if you will, baser motives, we could find ourselves in a very precarious position with respect to Iran. So that's the connection I would make.
Well, you've been a fabulous audience, staying longer than the allotted time, and we thank you, and please join me in thanking the panelists.